Recorded Books and RB Digital present. L. Ron Hubbard presents Writers of the Future, Volume 33, by David Farland. Narrated by Corey Allen, Morgan Hallett, Brian Hutchison, John Keating, and Richard Poe. Introduction by David Farland. David Farland is a New York Times best-selling author with over 50 novel-length works to his credit. As an author, David has won many awards for both his short stories and his novels. He won the grand prize in Writers of the Future, Volume 3, for his story On My Way to Paradise in 1987, and quickly went on to begin publishing novels. He has since won numerous awards for his longer works, including the Philip K. Dick Memorial Special Award, the Whitney Award for Best Novel of the Year, the International Book Award for Best Young Adult Novel of the Year, and the Hollywood Book Festival Book of the Year Award, among many others. Along the way, David has written a number of bestsellers, designed and scripted video games, such as the international bestseller StarCraft: Brood War, acted as a greenlighting analyst in Hollywood, and worked as a movie producer. David has long been involved in helping to discover and train new writers, including a number who have gone on to become number one international bestsellers, such as Brandon Mull, Fable Haven, Brandon Sanderson, The Way of Kings, James Dashner, The Maze Runner, Stephanie Meyer, Twilight, and many others. While writing Star Wars books for Scholastic, he was even asked to help choose a novel to push big for his publisher, and chose Harry Potter. David currently lives in Utah with his wife and children, where he is busily writing his next novel, working on a screenplay for a major motion picture, teaching workshops, and judging entries for L. Ron Hubbard Presents Writers of the Future, Volume 34. Introduction. 30 years ago, I entered the L. Ron Hubbard Writers of the Future contest and won first place. At the time, I was a student in college, studying hard for a triple major in editing, modern literature, and creative writing. My plan at the time was to learn to write well enough so that I could make my living as a novelist. But I suspected that it would take a decade of struggling, and so I would need to support myself with a more sensible job, such as editing, until I could make a living as a writer. A year earlier, I had won third place in a small short story contest, and I decided to make it a goal to try to win first place in that same college writing contest the next year. So over the year, I wrote a short story, and then another, and another, and so on, thinking that if I didn't win one contest, I might win some other one. It was sort of the shotgun approach to winning contests: write a whole bunch of short stories and then enter each one in a different contest. But I had my sights set on one in particular, the L. Ron Hubbard Writers of the Future. It was the big kahuna. You see, it had the best prize money of any of them. It paid $1,000 for the first-place winner in any quarter. And the word on the street was that from among the first-place winners, the panel of celebrity judges would choose a grand prize winner, who would receive another $5,000. I was with my writing group in Utah one Saturday evening and found that I felt sweaty and feverish. I went home to bed that night and had a vivid dream about a woman walking toward me in a dusty bazaar in Latin America. I awoke with a sensation that I desperately wanted to help her. But who was she? What did she need? Instantly, I was into a story. Unfortunately for me, or maybe fortunately, the fever stayed with me for months. I had to drop out of college for a couple of semesters, and I couldn't hold down a job, so I merely wrote. It took a month for me to finish my story, On My Way to Paradise, a tale about a doctor in the far future, and send it in to the contest. To my delight, I won first place in the contest for that quarter. Coincidentally, I won first place in several other contests within a few weeks of that. Word soon reached me that one of the judges, the legendary Robert Silverberg, had liked the story so much that he'd shown it to an editor, and there was a rumor that when I went to the award ceremony, I might be offered a novel contract. Well, that sounded great. I wanted to be a writer, but I'd imagined that I would have to work and claw my way up that mountain for years, and suddenly it seemed that I had a possible shortcut. That year, the Writers of the Future held its annual workshop for the winning writers at Sag Harbor on Long Island, a town where Ernest Hemingway sometimes would hang out as he wrote. For my instructors, I had the contest coordinating judge, Algis Budrus, along with a couple of hotshot young writers named Orson Scott Card and Tim Powers. We were put up in a hotel for a week and treated to a writing workshop taught by these and other legendary pros. At the end of the week, we had the annual award ceremony in New York. I was a bundle of nerves as we prepared for it. You see, the editor, who had said that he wanted to approach me at the award ceremony, suddenly passed away from a heart attack just a couple of weeks before the occasion, and it felt as if a rug had been pulled out from under me. At the award ceremony, we had some real celebrities, folks like Mark Hamill, Luke Skywalker, along with many of my favorite authors. Robert Silverberg was there, of course, but I remember being too tongue-tied to even speak to Gene Wolfe and Ray Bradbury. Then there were folks like Anne McCaffrey, Isaac Asimov, Larry Niven, Jerry Pournelle, Frederick Pohl, and others. Three of the first-place winners that year were men, and one of those winners was my dear friend Shane Bell. Part of me worried that I would beat my friend, and another part worried that he'd beat me. And then, of course, there was that disastrous possibility that we'd both lose. The one woman in our group got pulled aside and had her picture taken with Mark Hamill, in case she won, so that she might be featured for an article in Women's Day magazine. When that happened, I felt pretty sure that she was going to win. The ceremony took several hours, with the grand prize announced at the very last. To my surprise, I won the L. Ron Hubbard Golden Pen Award, and my life has never been quite the same since. After the award ceremony, I had several editors, not just one, approach me and ask to see my first novel. I had prepared a novel outline, but I only had brought a couple of copies, so I didn't know which of the eight editors to give them to. I took their cards and then contacted a literary agent a few days later. By the end of the week, my agent had contacted several of those editors, and I was given my first three-novel contract. Well, that's how the contest goes. It has grown a lot in the past three decades. Now it is one of the largest writing contests in the world, and each quarter it seems to get even bigger. Thousands of new writers send in entries, and the contest still provides the large prizes and the annual workshop taught by some of the most respected names in the field. Only 2 years after I won, the companion Illustrators of the Future contest was also added, using a very similar format, with three winners added per quarter and a grand prize winner selected each year. In the past 30 years, the contests have helped launch dozens of writers and illustrators to stardom, and I suspect that the contests will continue to launch many more careers. At one time, I was one of the bedazzled entrants. Now I'm the lead judge for the writing contest. Yet each time that I open a story to read it, I still feel hopeful. I'm hoping to find some young man or woman who is struggling to live their dreams and help pull them into the spotlight where they can be discovered by thousands of others. That's what this contest is all about. So read on. There are some authors and illustrators in this book that I want you to meet. I guarantee that some of them will be around for many, many years. This is your chance to discover them along with me.
Moonlight One, written by Stephen Lawson. About the author. Stephen Lawson lives in Louisville, Kentucky, with his wife, a rabbit, and a pair of bee colonies. Stephen spent 5 years on active duty with the Navy after high school and deployed three times. His carrier battle group deployed on September 19, 2001, as part of the immediate response to 9/11, which eventually became Operation Enduring Freedom. He has a business administration degree from Asbury University and is currently pursuing an MBA. He divides his time between church, writing, education, and a career as an officer in the Kentucky Army National Guard. Stephen's first publications were in Toasted Cheese Literary Journal's Dead of Winter Writing Contest. He also won first place in On the Premises 25th Contest with his story Gifted. He considers his biggest influences to be Michael Crichton, C.S. Lewis, Robert Heinlein, and team writers Douglas Preston and Lincoln Child. Moonlight One. Now. Gwen Kennedy dreamed that she lay on white sand, with the sun at just the right angle to warm her skin without burning it. Waves crashed 10 yards away, sending foam rippling to just below the edge of her blanket. Early lay next to her, reading one of his military history books. He flipped a page, then returned his bronzed arm to its place behind his head. "Isn't this perfect?" she asked. In speaking, she broke the dream. It faded into nothingness as she slowly opened her eyes in their bedroom. She rolled over to see if Early was awake so she could tell him about it, but her hand found an empty space where he slept. She looked up through the transparent aluminum dome that covered their bedroom. A vast, unfathomable sea of stars met her eyes, and there, low on the horizon, the Earth. Early had considered putting a canopy over their bed for privacy. "The only people on Earth with telescopes powerful enough to spy on us here," she'd said, "have more interesting things to look at than us making love or sleeping." It and the bathroom were the only areas Mission Command didn't have cameras. "I think our lovemaking is pretty interesting," Early had said. Now she had to pee, so she walked naked toward the bathroom across a Persian rug that had come on the last supply shuttle from Texas. She no longer bounced with every step as she had when they first arrived. While she worked out every day to prevent muscle atrophy, her mind had adapted to lunar gravity. Her feet pushed lightly against the carpet. Early had called it getting our moon legs. "Early?" she called softly. He didn't answer. Even after 3 months, the view hadn't gotten old. Lush vegetation and the endlessness of space. The open floor plan with transparent aluminum canopies was necessary to growing their food in an enclosed biosphere without wasting space. They even slept in hammocks in the forest biome sometimes, with the tiny galagos looking down at them from the foliage overhead. The bush babies, unfettered by Earth's gravity, would sail through the starlight overhead, leaping from limb to limb in the darkness. A galago could cross the main biome canopy, the rainforest, in about 5 seconds without ever touching the ground. "Early," she called again, louder this time. He wasn't in the bathroom. She stopped to relieve herself before grabbing her bathrobe from its hook. No need to give the boys at Mission Command a free peep show. She padded quietly through the edge of the grassland, taking a shortcut to the main relay closet. Early sometimes went there when he couldn't sleep to patch into amateur radio so that he could talk with hams on Earth. The grass grew higher and faster here than it did on Earth, needing less density to support its mass as it grew. She looked into the relay closet. Nope. "Early?" She started to worry, wondering if he'd tripped and hurt himself. Both of them drank, but only in moderation. The couple had been selected for a variety of factors too numerous to elaborate. Among them was the fact that they de-stressed easily, but never overdid it. A glass or two of wine a night, retreating to get personal space when necessary, and they were good. They'd brought an exercise bike and a rowing machine with them, neither of which required Earth's gravity for equal rigor. Early had brought heavy resistance bands as well, which replaced his weights on Earth. Since their resistance was a product of elasticity rather than mass, they offered the same workout. When they had to fight, they fought, but the fights were always brief and readily forgiven. They were, with little room for debate, the perfect couple for Moonlight One. She peeked in the material storage room, where they kept PVC and steel pipe, screws, sealants, replacement parts, and every other necessity to keep the biosphere inhabitable. No luck. Gwen smelled something unfamiliar lingering in the air. A petroleum-based lubricant like WD-40, but not something they had in the supply room. She shrugged it off and kept searching. As she entered the rainforest, Gwen looked up at the stars. The tiny black silhouette of a galago leaped across them, blotting them out for an instant. "Looks like somebody's following me." She'd walked halfway across the rainforest when a tiny green tree frog leaped near her feet, startling her. Only when she looked down did she see the black spots on the grass. Her eyes widened as she crouched to get a closer look. In the pale starlight, red had appeared black, but now she saw the blood for what it was. She stepped off the path, seeing more black patches and a faintly defined path through the foliage. She moved faster now, ignoring the leaves that whipped at her legs. She saw the gap in the foliage and knew before she looked into it that it was the shape of her husband. Gwen reached the place where the leaves had been crushed and fell to her knees in speechless shock. Early lay dead on the rainforest floor, his eyes staring blankly at the black-streaked leaves that surrounded him. His mouth hung open in a last, breathless gasp. Jonas Wren lay awake, staring at the reflected moonlight dancing on his ceiling. The water outside his houseboat rolled in gently under him, rocking him with what should have been sleep-inducing bliss. He felt through the sheets on his king-sized bed until he found his MacBook. He opened the screen and looked at the word count again. 38,000. Yesterday that said 37,500. At least I'm not on anybody's day planner tomorrow. He rose, casting aside a single silk sheet and a technical journal that he dropped at some point in his dozing insomnia. Jonas stepped out onto the deck in his boxers and lit a cigarette, feeling what he knew would be a too brief surge of calm and clarity. If I'm not going to sleep, I might as well write. Another boat, a cabin cruiser, rocked gently down the pier with a rhythm that didn't match the waves. At least somebody's having a good time being awake in the middle of the night. He just lit a second cigarette when a voice crackled from a speaker in his bedroom. KK4AJC, this is N4SVP, the feminine voice said. KK4AJC, N4SVP. He recognized the voice and call sign immediately, the voice causing a sudden pang that crept up through his heart to his brain and downward to his toes. He inhaled smoke, looked at his watch, closed his eyes briefly, then glanced at his watch again. Time didn't change. Not dreaming. He made it a practice not to smoke inside, but he really didn't want to discard the burning comfort right now. He walked back into the bedroom, holding the cigarette near the door. N4SVP, KK4AGC, he said finally. He held the microphone at arm's length while he exhaled out the open door. Jonas? Hi, Gwen, he said, trying to keep the mixed bitterness and excitement out of his voice. How's lunar life?
Jonas, you said if I ever needed you, I could reach you this way.
I remember, he said. He didn't add, but that was a year before you married my roommate. Where's Early?
He's
what?
He's dead, Jonas. Two people on the moon, and one of them's dead?
Can you access the internet up there? He asked.
Yes.
We can't have this discussion in the open. Use Tor to open up an encrypted chat. Jonas stubbed out the cigarette and slid back into bed. He opened his laptop, minimized pages, and opened a Tor browser. From there, he logged into the same encrypted chat site he'd been using since college. Lady Gwen O'Veer invited him to a private chat a moment later. How did Early die? Jonas typed.
I don't know, Gwen answered. I found him in the rainforest biome. I checked for a pulse, but he was already cold and stiff.
Does your control center know about this yet?
I radioed them 10 minutes ago to ask what they'd seen on the video feed.
And?
They said the feed cut out in the entire rainforest and several other sections about 4 hours ago. They told me to put him in cold storage, Jonas.
Don't move him.
Jonas, they're sending a team here. I think they think I killed Early.
When will the team get there?
5 days.
I know you're probably shaken up now, Gwen, but I need you calm and collected when you send me pictures. Close your eyes, give yourself 3 minutes, and breathe deeply.
Okay.
You're going to need to be emotionally detached from his body since you're the only other person on the moon. Repeat to yourself, the body on the ground is not my husband. My husband is in a better place, and the best thing I can do for him now is to be strong and get through this. The cursor blinked on Jonas's screen while he waited. He found the half-empty IPA on his bedside table and drank it down. What do I feel for Early? What would a normal guy feel right now? Should I even care?
Okay, Gwen typed. When I worked in homicide, Jonas said, we took dozens of pictures before we moved the body. Since I can't actually be there, pictures are all I'll have, so I'll need a lot of them. I need you to send me pictures of the body from every angle as it lays now. We need to do that before we move it or start looking at the surroundings. Okay, she said. I'll be back. Jonas picked up the copy of Advanced Robotics from the floor and noticed that it had been reopened to the article on successful remote hacks of EOD and military surveillance robots. He closed the magazine and placed it back in the drawer of his bedside table. He wished he had another curmudgeon IPA, but he was out, and he didn't feel like putting on pants. Has Early ever been seriously depressed? Jonas typed. He scrolled through the photos slowly, having connected his MacBook to the projector he watched movies on. The photos had taken an hour to upload through the EHF relay. Jonas didn't see any obvious trauma to Early's back, which meant the wound was probably in a potential self-inflicted area. You lived together for 4 years, Jonas. You know how he got. Then. You guys could be brothers, you know that? Gwen had said. It was their sophomore year at Wittenberg. She sat with her legs draped over Jonas's lap in their apartment. Why do you say that? Jonas had asked. You're both so smart, so methodical. You got into Wittenberg at 16, Jonas said. But you're also a pair of moody, sarcastic... Jolly fellows, Jonas offered. Assholes, Gwen said. Assholes is the word I was going to use. You're the one dating me, Jonas said, getting up to grab a third curmudgeon pilsner from the fridge. Ignorance is bliss, Gwen said. I couldn't date some fratty moron with a stupid grin on his face all the time. Yeah, Jonas had said. Early will come down eventually. He always does. I think he just climbs up on the roof to clear his head. He just got dumped, Jonas, and got the rejection letter. You should go talk to him. The wadded-up letter from NASA's internship program still lay on the floor next to the couch. Neither of them had dared to touch it, since discarding it and saving it were equally hazardous. Jonas stared at it now. He's fine, Jonas said. He takes things hard, but he gets over them fast. He just needs to be alone. I write, he broods. He'd taken a long pull of the pilsner. How do you drink that much and still swim for an hour every day? Gwen had asked. This is how I get my carbs. Anyway, don't worry about Early. He just needs to learn how to turn down the volume. Maybe you turn it down too much. Now. We can reconstruct the scene if we need to with these pictures, Jonas said. It's time to turn the body over, Gwen. Look for any obvious tears in his clothes. Look at the inside of his thighs, chest, sides, neck, and head. Then send me pictures from the same angles as before. He'd followed Gwen's career as much as she'd followed his. Baltimore homicide cop Jonas Wren slings best-selling police thrillers from The New Yorker. First woman to walk on the moon, Lunar X's Gwen Kennedy makes one giant leap for womankind, the headline had said. Cop turned novelist turned consulting detective, Wren solves murder that baffles Baltimore PD. The marathoner and the beauty queen, Kennedy's to be first couple in orbit together. Getting away with murder, Wren's anti-hero cop walks a dark path from lawman to outlaw. Husband and wife team to be the first long-term lunar residents. When Gwen and Early had shown up on the cover of Newsweek a month before the Oregon Trail launched, Jonas had marveled at how young they looked. He'd studied himself in the mirror, noting wrinkles that neither of them seemed to have. Was it the cigarettes or the dead bodies that put me in the time machine? More photos came through the chat window 2 hours later. I found the wound when I flipped him over, Gwen said. She'd sent several photos, zoomed in at various magnifications of a deep puncture wound. I took the first pics before I cleaned it. You can see in the later pics that it looks like the shape of a knife blade. Indeed it does. Jonas grabbed a knife from the block in the kitchen, looked again at the picture of the wound under Early's left arm, between ribs 5 and 6. He held it several ways, simulating several thrusts. If he'd been trying to kill himself quickly with a knife, he'd probably have gone for the heart. If he'd wanted punishment, he'd have committed seppuku. This wound didn't match either frame of mind. If the blade was long enough, it had very likely hit Early's heart, but it had passed through his lung to do so. "Gwen," Jonas typed, "have you been having trouble sleeping again?" Then. Jonas had woken in the middle of the night with a sense that something wasn't right. He'd crashed on the couch, which was less than he'd been hoping for, at Early's family's cabin. The 2-hour scenic drive had allowed Gwen to chat with Early's new girlfriend, and they'd spent a relaxing evening by the lake. Gwen had been in a rare mood that night, flirting seductively, then locking Jonas out of the bedroom. Now Jonas heard the wind in the trees more clearly than he should have, and rose to find the back door of the cabin open. "Gwen?" She hadn't answered. She'd just stood, barefoot in a t-shirt and pajama pants, staring into the forest. "Baby?" He'd stepped closer, put a hand on her shoulder, but she'd only mumbled something unintelligible. Jonas had looked into the wood line, seen a pair of eyes watching their interaction. They were too far from the ground to be a bobcat, probably a bear. He cursed himself for leaving his .45 next to the couch. "Come on, babe," Jonas had said, gently nudging her toward the cabin. He kept glancing at the glowing orbs in the shadow, searching in the darkness for something he could use as a weapon. He had found a splitting axe next to the woodpile, but when he'd glanced back to the forest, the eyes had vanished. "Wow," Gwen had said the next morning. "I really don't remember any of that." "Did you sleepwalk when you were little?" Jonas had asked. "No, not that my parents ever told me about anyway," she'd said. "I've been having trouble sleeping this semester, though, so I started taking Ambien." Jonas had spent a week reading articles about Ambien's horrific side effects and tried to convince Gwen to get a different prescription. She needed her sleep, though, and it wasn't the last time it happened. Now. "In law enforcement," Jonas said, "we'd call this an open and shut case. In the writing world, though, we'd call it an intriguing mystery." The beer buzz had abandoned him an hour ago, and he now applied heat to his vacuum coffee brewer. "This isn't a story, Jonas. It's Early's life. It's my life." As the water began to evaporate and travel into the upper chamber, he popped 2 Tylenol in his mouth and drank a quart of water. The rising sun told him he wouldn't be allowed to die of insomnia today. Time to turn the volume back up. "It was still a story, though, and one I intend to capitalize on once we solve it. There are several things we need to look at next to determine if you did this in your sleep or whether we should keep looking."
"Okay."
"First, I need you to account for all of Early's in your clothing. If anything is missing or has blood on it, I need to know. Second, examine your bathroom. If there's still water on the floor of the shower or blood on the floor of the bathroom, I need to know."
"You want to see if I stabbed him in my sleep? Then cleaned up and got back into bed?"
"Right. Third, account for all the knives in the station. If one of your monkeys or whatever got a hold of one, it will either be missing or have blood on it."
"I didn't think about the Galagos," Gwen said. "I don't even know if they could hold a kitchen knife."
"It's a good thing I read Poe. While you're looking at clothes and knives, though, I need to do some analysis here. Can you send me a detailed floor plan of the entire station and a log of which areas lost their camera feeds last night?"
"Sure," she said. "It'll only take about 10 minutes.
While he waited for the floor plan, Jonas Googled Lunar X competitors. Space Corps loses NASA contract for International Space Station resupply. He bookmarked the article and kept searching. Mars 2050 loses venture capital funding to Lunar X. Another bookmark. 10 minutes later, Gwen sent him the floor plan. He printed it and pushed a thumbtack through the paper into the wall.
It's about time I spend my money on something. If this pans out, I'll buy a whole new houseboat.
While Gwen went off to inventory clothes and knives, Jonas studied the layout, shading in areas where the log indicated the cameras had stopped working. He pictured one of the tiny Galagos with a knife in its paw. Not likely, but we can't start eliminating suspects just yet. Next, he printed the news clippings of Lunar X's competition. He hung an old, long-abandoned whiteboard next to the floor plan and wrote, "Early. Suicide? Where's the knife? Gwen. Ambien? Most likely. Lunar X competition. How? Study the floor plan. Angry Galagos?" He smirked, hesitated, then wrote, "Lunar natives?" It wasn't out of the question. The moon had some pretty dark cracks and crevices, which were the only places water could escape photolysis. Perhaps the natives, heretofore unmet by the Apollo missions or unmanned rovers, had decided that enough was enough and that they weren't putting up with colonization. Jonas drew a gray man with big eyes on the whiteboard. "Is there anyone else?" "Do you have maintenance robots?" Jonas typed. He knew Gwen wouldn't respond while she was busy taking stock, but it was other information he didn't have. When he'd re-examined the wound pictures at the highest magnification, he'd noticed something odd. It was a high-velocity strike without jagged rips on either side. This had been done with machine-like precision and withdrawn as fast as it had entered. He wrote, "Robot, likely, possible hack by a competitor," on the whiteboard. He felt vibrant. He was back in action again, after months of letting dust settle on his eyelids. He'd been dead, rocked to sleep in a Viking funeral on his houseboat. Now he was alive with problems, a murder, a mystery, albeit one too eerily close to home. Then. "You shouldn't smoke," the girl had said. "Smoking's bad for you." "You're in a bar, trying to convince some guy to take you seriously enough to go home with. You're in no place to lecture me," Jonas had said. "Still, smoking's an easy choice." "Wren's Gwen is Early's girly," Jonas had said. Little bits of literary wit came to him when he drank, but he only remembered a third of them when sober. "Hmm?" the girl asked. She'd stared at him with big green eyes, surrounded by too much eyeliner, amused. "My fiance called off our wedding. Now she's dating my roommate."
"What? Tonight?"
"No, 2 months ago," Jonas had said. "But I can't write anymore. I just don't have a story in me. I want to see people die." He'd bought the girl a rum and coke. She smiled, entertained by his misery.
"That's dark, man. Are you going to be a serial killer?"
He'd studied her. She was black and white, like every other girl he'd ever met. She was boring, mundane, bovine. Gwen had been the only one in color.
"Maybe."
"Can I help?" the girl had asked.
"I think I'll be a cop for a while," he'd said. "A cop is a good place to start."
It had been. Jonas had learned enough about police procedure to fill a series of cheap paperback novels and earned enough to fund an MFA in writing when he'd gotten his nerve back. That girl had been the first in a series of relationships with black and white, ghostly, nothing people that had lasted 5 years. Black and white, but with an amazing wreck, Jonas had thought. Just like Granddad's porn collection. They'd amused each other, but now she was just an ink blot in his memory. When Jonas awoke on his houseboat 5 years later, he didn't even care about what he'd been chasing. He didn't care about anything. The houseboat was black and white, too. He'd looked down at the cover of Newsweek with Gwen smiling her supermodelly perfect white smile next to Early in full color and known he'd failed at some point. He was on the New York Times bestseller list, but he was a failure. Now. Jonas finished what he felt was an exhaustive list of possibilities and a thorough crime wall for visualizing the case. He sat in his swivel chair and glanced over the limited possibilities. After a moment, he picked up a paperback copy of his last novel, ripped off the back cover, and tacked his own picture under the list of suspects. Then, with a lack of sleep finally catching up to him, he turned up the volume on the chat window and settled into a nap.
No bots, Gwen said. Mission Command figured it'd be one more thing that would break and require replacement parts. Some of the systems are automated, but not by anything with moving limbs.
There goes my best theory.
Did you find anything in the inventory?
I accounted for all our clothes, Gwen typed. With limited living space, we were extremely detailed about what we brought. Nothing's missing, and the floor in the shower is dry. I walked around the pond and the rice paddy too. No sign of blood.
What about the knives? Jonas asked.
The kitchen knives were all in the block. We have some box cutters and X-Acto knives, but they were all in the shop and the tool trays. We have cutouts for all the tools to make inventories easier.
All clean?
I looked at every single blade we have. No blood, and no water in the sink from washing. If I did this in my sleep, I was pretty thorough.
Go through your machine shop and look for evidence of grinding. It's unlikely, but maybe one of you made a shiv.
Jonas,
we have to eliminate possibilities, and I need to think, he said. She could be using me to hide evidence before the team gets there. I was a cop, after all. I know where a cop would look. Maybe she wasn't even asleep.
Jonas pushed the thought from his mind. If someone killed early on purpose, I can't really blame them. He stepped out onto the deck, squinting at the sun. Hey, Jonas, a feminine voice called from the pier. He paused in the act of lighting a cigarette to wave at Sandy Robinson and her tiny white dog. We haven't seen you at the pool lately.
I know, he said sheepishly. I've been in a mood.
Nobody does laps like you do. I tell Stuart you're part fish.
Jonas chuckled at this as Sandy walked her little dog off to crap on dry land. He caught the lyrics of a blaring song as a boat accelerated away from the marina into the open water. He nearly dismissed it, but something about the 90s song stuck in his mind. The cop part of him said not to ignore his gut. The writer part said he had to be more creative than he'd been so far. It's a song by Aerosmith, I think. It was from a movie. Something about space. Jonas grabbed his laptop and brought it out to the deck. Before opening a tab for IMDb, he reread part of Wikipedia's article on the moon. He skimmed it and clicked a link to the article on Project Horizon. He stopped skimming and took in every single word. Jonas stubbed out his cigarette. He went back into the bedroom, picked up a dry erase marker, and began to draw.
There's nothing in the shop that would indicate someone made a shiv, Gwen said.
I'm assuming you guys have spacesuits to do external repairs and for emergencies, Jonas said.
We do.
Is there some sort of computer log of when they're used, or when your airlock is opened?
Of course, she said. We talk to Mission Command every time we go out, too, so they have a record.
Do you have some sort of wheeled vehicle?
Yes, the truck's electric. We use it to collect samples to send back to the resupply landers.
Okay, this one's important. Have your cameras ever gone out before?
Well, yeah. Early would always fix them. He said it was just a bad circuit board. It was usually just the one near the airlock, though. This is the first time the one in the rainforest went out.
But he had to fix that same circuit board repeatedly?
Yeah.
I need you to take pictures of your entire relay closet and send them to me. Then I need you to look through Early's books for anything handwritten that seems remotely out of place, especially anything that looks like coordinates. It's a pretty far-fetched solve, but it's the only one that makes sense. Then, realizing the implications of what he was thinking, Jonas copied the text of the chats to a USB drive, along with the lunar station's floor plan and the camera logs. He placed the flash drive in a Pelican case and set it on the bedside table. Gwen uploaded the images from the relay closet, and Jonas began scrolling through them. He wasn't a technical wizard, but he had to search for anything out of place.
The radio on the second shelf down on the far right looks like a ham setup. Is that the one you called me on? He asked.
Yes. It's the only one that Lunar X didn't supply. It's Early's rig.
He could get any band on it.
He built several of the antennas himself.
Go through all the bands and send me all the presets.
An hour later, Jonas had copied this list as well and added it to the flash drive. Gwen had gone back to looking through their books and Early's personal effects, while Jonas started plugging repeater frequencies into Google.
I found something, Gwen typed.
Me too.
It was in his little book that he wrote down ham call signs that had contacted him. Inside the back cover, he'd written down a set of numbers. I looked up the grid in our Atlas software.
And?
And those coordinates were in the darkest shadow of Russell Crater. It's a place that never gets direct sunlight. We've never collected samples from there.
How long would it take to get there? In your electric truck?
Probably an hour. We've never taken it that far.
Early did. You have a little over 3 days until that lander shows up with a team that won't want to hear far-fetched conspiracy theories. Here's what we need to do.
It happened that night, but not in the way Jonas had expected. He'd closed his eyes for another nap with his 1911 close at hand. He'd always been a light sleeper, and knew that crunching footfalls on the broken glass he'd scattered on the deck would awaken him, or the blaring of the motion sensor alarm, or the barking of the Robinson's little white yappy dog. Instead of bullets, though, an incendiary grenade landed on his deck, and the houseboat caught on fire. Of course they'd know I smoke. Stupid author burns his stupid houseboat to the waterline with his stupid cigarettes. Stupid Jonas Wren drowns, burns, and dies of lead poisoning simultaneously. All this at the top of the hour. Jonas had put enough murderers behind bars to know one of them might come looking for him someday. He kicked out the escape panel on the starboard side and stuffed the Pelican case, wallet, phone, 1911, a t-shirt, and athletic shorts into a dry bag. He'd planned for this and rehearsed it 100 times, knowing that muscle memory would save him when the shit hit the fan. Even as his hands moved to save him, though, he watched them shake. He took a moment to try to calm his nerves, but his hands still shook. Let them shake. I nearly pissed myself the first time I had to draw my duty weapon, but I walked out alive. The other guy didn't. He clipped the dry bag to a carabiner, which he then clipped to a rope that descended from the side of the boat into the water. He pulled his mask over his eyes and nose and did a quick check of the seal. Then, as quietly as he could, he eased himself over the side and into the darkness next to the dry bag. Flames crept slowly over the cabin, and he knew someone would be waiting in the shadows of the pier to ambush him. Instead of obliging them, he grabbed the dry bag in one hand and pulled it and himself hand over hand to the bottom of the bay. It was a nice boat. Good thing I didn't spend my advance yet. Not sure if I have assassin insurance. He found the regulator by feel and put it in his mouth, then pushed the button once to purge. With the survival problem solved, he took his time strapping on the two-tank rig and fins he'd practiced getting into 100 times before. The best thing about a houseboat is the basement's huge and nobody follows you down the stairs. Still, it was cold, and Jonas held the tritium wrist compass close to his mask. He could blame his shaking hands on the water when he got out. I hope Gwen's faring better. This is going to make one hell of a book. Gwen sat at the edge of the Russell crater, attempting to digitally zoom the camera in on what she'd found. Once she'd left the habitat, she hadn't even needed the map. Early's footprints led to the truck, and its wheels left a trail all the way to Russell crater. Without wind or rain, nothing but meteorites or men would erase them. What left the other set of tracks, though? The tank treads that go right to the airlock. She closed her eyes, breathing slowly. She was good at stress management, but she'd started to feel the crushing emptiness of the void 10 minutes after leaving Moonlight One. Then she'd felt the crushing weight of being the only human on the moon, followed by Jonas's theory that Early had exploited her and been killed by a DoD security robot.
She wouldn't let herself cry, though. She knew that would come later, when she was safe. For now, she had to be strong. She opened her eyes. Focus on now. Early's dead. Don't join him. She kept the camera on full motion video as long as the batteries would hold out, and she wasn't disappointed. The empty spacesuit stood at the edge of the crater for a full 15 minutes before one of the security robots impaled it from behind. She'd followed Jonas's instructions to the letter, keeping a low profile and remaining in the shadows. The truck remained hidden behind a large rock 200 meters away. What were you into, Early? Who were you sending information to? Everyone had seen Armageddon, Jonas had reasoned. Even men at the Pentagon, whose job it was to worry about mankind's continued existence. They would have seen a lunar launch platform for nuclear missiles as a four-day head start against an extinction event, and with less fuel required to achieve escape velocity. Keep the rocks between you and them, Jonas had said. They'll likely have thermal cameras, and the truck will radiate heat even if your suit insulates your body. They'll have normal optics, too. The same guys that watched Armageddon watched Predator. Of course, they couldn't tell anyone about the platform or set up restricted no-go zones on the moon unless they wanted to keep it staffed perpetually. The staffing and launch schedule would have drawn attention, and then everyone would know there were nukes on the moon. No. It was better to post a few automated sentries with bladed weapons to keep the site secure. Standard small arms would have cold-welded together in the vacuum of space, as would a railgun and its projectiles. The space shuttle program had been the perfect cover. They couldn't land on or take off from the moon since they required standard airstrips and wings that didn't work in the vacuum. They did, however, have large cargo bays that absolutely no one on Earth paid attention to. They were perfect for secondary launches of lunar landers, with materials to build the launch platform. If it had been carried out by DOD, Project Horizon would have failed miserably, and everyone knew it. Only a civilian organization, with seemingly innocent intent, could carry out mankind's finest wall of defense against the void. I'm just amazed I never pictured an ICBM in the bay of a space shuttle until Jonas suggested it. What did people think NASA was doing up here? Science experiments with houseplants? Having captured enough provably undoctored footage to show what had killed Early, Gwen crept backward into the shadows toward the truck. Now to upload. It wasn't ideal, but she'd been left no choice. If she showed Lunar X what she'd found, they'd quietly meet with NASA and subsequently lock her away for Early's murder. They'd be good Americans and sacrifice one for the good of many. I'll be damned if I'm going to be that one. This is going to every media outlet I can find in the next 3 days. Gwen hooked into the truck's supplementary oxygen and eased away from Russell Crater. Nobody really uses ham radio that much anymore, Jonas typed. The internet took over for indestructible communication, and it's more versatile. That's how Early knew no one would catch on his exchanging information through swap meets. The FCC and NSA pay far more attention to more advanced, more widely accessible media. Jonas looked down from the screen of his new laptop to his cowboy boots. They weren't his style, and they were therefore perfect. All that time, he was trying to sell secrets I knew nothing about, Gwen said. The thing is, I used to think he needed space every time he went to the roof. He may very well have been talking to a handler. He's the one that got me into ham radio back then. Gwen fell silent for a moment. He only turned on the charm after I got the internship with Lunar X. He saw a way to get to the moon, she said finally. Jonas sighed, looked away from the screen. You were the only one that was ever in color for me. And you left me for a damned liar. A traitor. I'm sorry for your loss, Gwen, he typed. The cursor blinked for several seconds on Jonas's screen before another message appeared. I heard a noise, Gwen said. I think maybe something followed me from Russell Crater. I'm starting the upload in case something goes wrong. While Jonas watched an upload percentage bar 238,900 miles away, Gwen crept stealthily across the rainforest floor. There it was again, a mechanical clinking and grinding that didn't coincide with anything in the biosphere. It sounded like tank treads. She knew the thing probably wouldn't have aural sensors, since its creators would only have expected it to operate in the nearly non-existent lunar atmosphere. She moved as quietly as she could nonetheless, not wanting to make a fatal error based on an assumption. The auxiliary lighting flickered out along the path. She looked up at the cameras that linked to Lunar X Mission Command. Both of their red, live-feed LEDs had gone dark. These were the last things Early saw before it caught up to him. I wonder if the bot hacked our power grid itself, or if he has help on the ground. She started toward the storage room, with all the extra pipe and replacement parts. She hadn't really gauged the reach of the sentry's arms, but a steel pipe was probably her best bet. This is near where I found Early's body. He must have thought the same thing. LG-4201 rolled into Target M's last known position. A pair of red-orange footprints illuminated the undergrowth, but the trail ended there. LG-4201 panned its optical array 90 degrees left, then right. It switched between the human visible spectrum and thermal several times, knowing the human could insulate herself in a spacesuit. Gwen floated to the ground behind LG-4201. It had taken a bit of work to break the limb with her bare hands, but she'd finally managed to wrench it free. When she'd leaped into the branches, she'd prayed that the thing wouldn't look up as it searched for her. She'd bent the forked, leafy branch back and forth harder and harder until it tore. She needed the bushiest stick she could get. That's what Steve Irwin had always used to pin down snakes. She swung and hit the back of the robot's head, but didn't feel it give at all. LG-4201 spun on its treads, fast. Too fast. Its slow, methodical hunt had given her a false sense of how quickly it would react. She shoved the leaves hard into its camera array, blinding it temporarily. She pushed forward, trying to break loose one of the cameras or push it off balance. The thing pivoted on its treads, collapsed the hydraulic pistons in its torso slightly, then slashed upward with one of its blade arms. All the leaves were gone, and Gwen was left with a short wooden club. Her knees shook. I can make it back to the lower branches if I jump now, she thought. Before she could escape, LG-4201 lunged with its other blade, and Gwen lost her balance as she dodged the attack. She stumbled backward. I'm dead, she thought. You killed us, Early. You killed your wife, you asshole. LG-4201 rolled forward, slowly again, with its blade arm spread wide to skewer target M, should she roll to either side. At least Jonas will have the video. A tiny ball of fur leaped down from one of the low branches behind LG-4201, then another. They landed on the thing's shoulders, fangs bared in feral rage as they tore at the four-camera array. Gwen had never seen the Galagos react violently to anything, but LG-4201 was the only predator that had ever entered the biosphere. Early's death had forced them to adapt. Early and Gwen had cared for the bush babies, and so they'd become part of the pack. The thermals landed at Gwen's feet as LG-4201 attempted to slash at its own head. Its creators had apparently not wanted the robot to decapitate itself, because Gwen watched as the Galagos continued their violent work inside the mechanical stops of the thing's blades. It couldn't touch them. The secondary cameras flew to the undergrowth as LG-4201 spun violently, slashing at enemies it could no longer see. Gwen sprinted in a wide circle behind it, heading for the storeroom. She needed something heavier than a tree branch. The Galagos leaped away as soon as Gwen was out of danger, but LG-4201 still spun and slashed wildly through the undergrowth. Gwen studied the range of its arm movements for several minutes before she ran forward and shoved the thing as hard as she could, toppling it. As LG-4201 attempted to right itself with its blade arms,
Gwen brought down a heavy piece of steel pipe on its left elbow, throwing it off balance again. She moved to the right elbow, then the treads. 15 minutes later, LG4201's power supply lay in the undergrowth next to a spreading pool of hydraulic fluid. In the starlight, it didn't look much different from Early's blood. Having watched Edward Snowden's fiasco, Jonas knew better than to hope for an honest hearing from anyone in the United States government. Their only hope, he told Gwen, was to go public, but they could never go home. They'd release the story through Israeli and British news agencies in return for a promise of a continuous live broadcast of her lander's entry and splash in the Northeast Atlantic. Intercepting its path with a missile, at that point, would have only earned international bad favor with no reward. When Jonas watched Gwen being recovered from the icy waters onto a private yacht, he knew he'd assessed their calculus correctly. No reason to piss everyone off now that it's out in the open. He watched with amusement as the BBC's cameraman zoomed in on the two Galagos Gwen had squeezed into the lander with her. Did we do the right thing, Jonas? Gwen asked over a live chat. She'd settled in France. She'd asked electronically several times over the intervening months where Jonas was hiding, but he'd never told her. The color's gone from her. I guess it bleeds out when you're second place to someone who played us both. Lunar X would have sold you out behind closed doors to keep their NASA contracts, Jonas said. Our government would have considered you an acceptable loss. Yeah, we did the right thing. Early screwed up, and we did what we had to do to survive. Jonas sat on the beach of Pitcairn Island, his money worthless in their barter economy. He closed his laptop and felt Reiki's gentle hands on his shoulders. He watched the sunset, regretting only for a moment the fact that everyone on Pitcairn is a Seventh-day Adventist, and therefore a teetotaler. Can't spend my loads of money or buy a drink. At least they won't look for me here, he thought. He looked back at Reiki, and she smiled in the pink twilight. At least it's in color.
The Armor Embrace, written by Doug C. Souza. About the author. Doug C. Souza grew up in a home with a playful love for the arts. His early memories include recording skits on cassette tapes with his brother and sister. That evolved into motion videos using He-Man toys. All the while, his parents sat down and enjoyed every creative endeavor as if it were a night at the movies. For years, Doug only shared his stories with family. About 7 years ago, he ventured out to a local writing group to seek a way to improve his craft, or grasp some understanding of it. He was so nervous about sharing his work that he almost used an alias, so he could hightail it out of there if need be. Sharing his work with others was a huge step in Doug's writing adventure. There was still plenty to be fixed within his writing, but the fire was sufficiently stoked. That first group was also where he heard of the writers of the future. To this day, the best advice Doug ever received was to read, 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 and write, write, write. Well, that and the link to William Shun's formatting website. Doug C. Souza hopes you enjoy his story in the anthology. But if you're a writer, he hopes you read a couple more and then get back on the crazy train. He lives in Modesto, California, with his lovely wife, Nicole, and their mini tornado of a daughter. She's a mini tornado in a good way. The Armor Embrace. My mountainous mech suit isn't built for subtlety. The steel talons scrape against the sidewalk as I creep up behind Flora. She whips around so fast, her light brown locks drape her face. Flora doesn't scream, just brushes away her hair and gazes at me. A 10-year-old girl facing a 10-foot Viathan mech soldier of the Slayer class. I had promised myself I'd just watch her for a short spell, you know, to convince myself she's going to be okay. Keep the walking tank hidden as she strolled home from school.
I imagined her with a group of bubbly friends, chatting about goofy things. But she was alone, quiet and alone with her head down. Not the playful Flora I remembered. After watching her walk by, I reneged on my promise and snuck up behind her, not having any idea what I'd say or do. A grin spreads across Flora's face. She's gazing up at the tinted face shield to the pilot pit, as if this is a typical Tuesday afternoon. I know she can't see past the onyx glass, but it feels like she's looking into my soul.
"Well, hi, Dad," she says.
"Hello." The external speakers crackle in the computerized voice. I want to say her name, but can't. Flora inches closer, drops her backpack, and puts a hand on my chromium shin.
"It's just like the pics and vids you sent."
She's bouncing as she talks.
"But way, way bigger and dirtier."
"Yes," the computerized voice agrees.
"Where'd you come from?"
she asks, glancing past me.
"Where were you hiding?"
I raise the mech's right arm, a massive tungsten and titanium alloy, and motion toward the Macmillan's Airstream camper.
"Oh, okay,"
she says with a nod. I drop a quick link to the local police scanner, waiting for the call to come in. I don't have much time.
"Some tightwads came by and said you deserted,"
Flora says as she flicks some of the dried mud off the outer leg casing. Tightwads. Funny word to describe the brigade reps. I wonder how much they told her. "Yes," the computerized voice answers. Again, I want to say more to try and explain myself.
Isn't that like running away?"
she asks. Her deep brown eyes look up. They fill my internal view screen. I snap a pic and store it. Only 6 months have passed, but it seems so much longer. She seems so much older. Every bit as beautiful as I remember. "Yes," I have the computerized voice admit. With great caution, I move the Viathan's giant hand and extend one of the tentacled fingers. I gingerly brush the artificial appendage across Flora's cheek. Servos within the finger click and whir. Flora doesn't flinch. Had she always been so brave? Sensors send back thermal readings, pulse rate, even perspiration content. It's not the same as feeling her warmth, her soft flesh dimpling under my touch.
"You're working that with your mind, huh?"
Flora says. Her tiny voice is rich with curiosity. I don't answer. She tries again.
"Well, you know, with the brainwiring stuff you told me about."
Fragments of a sunny morning. Flora and I were sitting out back, me on the steps, her practicing dribbling a basketball. An older kid at school had told her a rough summation of the cerebral implants and nano-chelated fibers used for motor control within the Viathan's neural interface.
"Stabbing wires into the controller's brain through holes in the skull,"
or something like that. The crass description had frightened her. Actually, the access port runs smoothly between the second and third cervical vertebrae. The mesh of wires feeds through a catheter that links to the motor cortex. I had made up a lie that day about the neural stent nodes being more like braces on teeth and simplified how thoughts were translated from chemical reactions and electrical impulses to move the mech's limbs. There was no mention of the ghost line, the moment when you no longer control the machine consciously, but your thoughts and actions become fluid within the mech. Holographic icons appear with the mere thought. Vegeta protein pumps in softly like a second heartbeat. You try not to think about biomass recycling. Or the oddest sensation, echoes of consciousness that are difficult to decipher whether they came from you or the mech's onboard stream processor. Looming over her as she awaits an answer on this empty street, I find I'm just watching her. "Yes," the computerized voice finally answers.
"But it doesn't hurt you?"
I can't help but pause a beat before answering, enough for her to doubt me. "No," I lie. Flora reaches up and puts her hand around the mech's finger. Another memory startles me. Her tiny hand wrapping around my finger. She's an infant, crying as blood gets drawn. The mech shudders, can't process the conflicting images. A piercing ache flames through my mind. The internal view screen flickers and then shuts off. I'm left in darkness. First, the upper torso locks into place, and then the rest of the mech stops. I'm left in an awkward pose like a statue. No, I cry, but my voice has gone mute. Reassess the situation. Again, there's no sound. Only my phantom thoughts as I try to steady the machine. Ever since leaving my unit, I've been battling with the mech's onboard stream processor. The heavy damage from our last engagement left me mentally scattered, as if I'm teetering on the bridge of the ghost line with the machine. I'm jolted as I remember how a line of spiker projectiles homed in on our positions. The sharp ammo rained down on us. Something has brought the memory forward. An ambush I can't quite recall. There's the split second when the mech was impaled, then an all-out jumble of metal clanging and grinding. The line of mechs falling over one another. Some mech shooting his railgun while twirling around, hitting allies. Stop. That's over. It was the blood. Remembering Flora's tiny bead of blood. A vision of my own blood. Pooled around me and mixed with oils as my mech's lumbering hands pull spiker projectiles from the outer hull of the pilot pit. Med nanos crawled across my entombed body to mend multiple impact wounds. My organic arms locked in the machine's mechanical arms, stuck and unable to do anything as the med nanos crawled across me like a swarm of ants. Ants that needled into my skin and then latticed together to stabilize the bleeding at various entry points. The Viathan wouldn't allow me access to the command interface with such an erratic heart rate and place me under animate hibernation. The spiker projectiles had damaged the encrypted comnet link to the unit CO as well. It was the first time I felt alone with the machine. Later, I awoke to the mech running through an orchard of white blossoms. Must have accessed an auto-retreat protocol. Took me a good 10 minutes to regain primary controls. The onboard stream processor was filled with gaps and error messages. Somehow, I had survived. And my only thoughts were getting home to my wife and little girl. Actually, my hopes throughout that horrid deployment were to return home as soon as possible. Flora. Back with Flora. Almost home. The old memory blinks away. Sunlight warms the mech's hull. Back in the present, operating systems reboot and the internal view screen lights up. The image of Flora examining me blurs and then refocuses. The sunny street comes into view. The row of houses sharpens into a discernible image. Solar cells report fully functional, so my power feed isn't an issue. Flora places her palm on the face shield. "Why aren't you talking?" she asks. Her eyes shine in a way that tells me she knows what lies beneath. "Damaged," the voice explains. I point to the.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.